Welcome. Today we're very happy to have Dr. Tibor Torok from Predictive Science Incorporated, or PSI, or PSI, I think. And Tibor received his PhD in astrophysics from the University of Potsdam in Germany in 2004. And after that, he worked as a postdoc researcher at first at the Mullard Space Science Lab in UK, and then at Paris Observatory. And in 2010, he came to the US and joined PSI, where he's currently a research physicist or a research scientist. And one of his major research areas in MHD simulation for solar and plasma physics. And at PSI, he has worked on numerical modeling for CME. And for his very innovative work in that field, he earned the 2013 Karen Harvey Prize. Today he's going to talk about CME, I guess.
Okay, hello everybody. Thanks a lot for the invitation. It's always a pleasure to be here. First thing I want to say is that this talk is essentially the very same one I gave at SPD. So those of you who were there, I'm not angry if you do something maybe more important. Okay, so what I want to talk about a little bit today is the modeling of CMEs, of solar eruptions, numerical modeling. And that's, of course, a pretty wide topic, so I can only touch certain aspects of it, and mostly stuff I worked on, of course. And let's start with a little outline. So I have a little introduction telling you what solar eruptions are with a few movies. And then I want to say something about how we use these observations to constrain our modeling and what methods we are using. And then I picked two, let's say, still open questions I was working on as an example of what we do. One is how CMEs are triggered and driven, and the other is, which attracted some attention lately, is whether eruptions are coupled or may be coupled, meaning that one can trigger the other. And as you will see, all these models I will show what I worked on are relatively simple, small boxes, Cartesian, mostly zero beta approximation. And there is another family of models where the guys at PSI work on, and I started to work on that too, which you can call state of the art. These are, I call them global and thermodynamic models. So I will show you this at the end. Okay. So let's get started. What are solar eruptions? Well, the first thing to notice or to note is that these are the largest energy release events we have in the solar system. And the biggest eruptions can release up to 10 to 25 joule. And to give you an idea, I wrote down here the current annual world energy consumption. And you see that with one of these big eruptions, basically, we can feed ourselves with energy of for several 10,000 years for the whole world. Fortunately, we cannot get to it. Okay, the next thing to say, general things that they occur in the atmosphere of the sun, more precisely in the corona. And observationally, there are three main types. We have erupting prominences or filaments, we have CMEs, and we have flares. Now I would like to walk you through these three quite briefly. So let's start with a flare. What is a flare? So basically, from observational point of view, a flare is a sudden, strong, and localized increase of emission from the sun, which most best visible in EUV and X-ray wavelengths. So here are some light curves, hard X-ray, soft X-ray, so you see it can go up quite a while. And you see this then in the telescope as a strong flash. And later on in the evolution, when the emission slowly shrinks down, we see ribbons, this typical pair of ribbons which move apart in H-alpha mostly, and we can see these beautiful arcades. And here's a sketch of Richard Carrington. This is, to my knowledge, the first flare which was ever observed in 1859. This is a drawing from a sunspot group, and here these two white stripes you see are presumably the ribbons. Okay, so here this is just for your entertainment. These are three examples of these large flares, three well-known cases. I don't want to go into the details. This is just to show their beauty. And the Bastille flare, here was one observed by Trace, and this one was observed by, can you hear me if I turn? Yes, by Hinode. Okay, so we will get back to this, how these things work. Next thing are prominence eruptions. Here's a picture and a movie by Tom Berger. So prominences, as you know, are dense and cool structures, long elongated structures which are held by magnetic fields in the much hotter corona. They can reach lengths of even up to half a solar radius, and of course in the active regions those are smaller, but essentially they are the same things. And they can be stable, particularly the large ones like you see here, for weeks or months, but eventually most of them, if not all of them, erupt. And since I'm at HAO today, of course I have to show this one. This is an observation made here in 1945, I think, or 46. That's the famous granddaddy. So here you see how this prominent structure erupts. So we had flares, prominences, and finally we have the CMEs, or coronal mass ejections, which are these huge expulsions of plasma and magnetic field from the corona. I put some numbers here so they can reach masses of 10 billion tons, up to 10 billion tons. And the very fastest one, this is the fastest one I found, was about 3,500 kilometers per second was the peak speed. And during, especially if the sun is very active, you can have several of them a day. And interestingly, at least to me, is that in contrast to flares and prominences, they were discovered pretty late. So you guys probably know this better than me, but I think this is the first CME observation which was made in 1971. Although, apparently, one has seen this even earlier. So here's a drawing of a solar eclipse from 1860. This is all drawings, and you see this structure here, which likely was a CME. Okay, finally, this is a movie to give you an impression how violent these things are. So here's the sun. This is an EIT observation, and the field of view is from the Lascaux coronagraph, and this movie spans about 2 weeks during the famous Halloween events 10 years ago. And you see these are really huge and strong expansions. All right. Okay, so why do we care? Why is this interesting? Of course, we are interested in understanding these things in the first place, but of course, the main thing is space weather. So these eruptions can hit the Earth, as you see in this, how you call this, in this artist's imagination movie. So they can cause geomagnetic storms, flares, can knock out satellites, power grids, and so on. So I don't want to go into that because that's a big, long topic. Here's a sketch which summarizes some of this things these eruptions can do. And of course, one of our main goals is in understanding these eruptions, we want at some point be able to forecast them and also to forecast the impact they can have on Earth. All right, so now before we can do any modeling, we need, of course, a couple of constraints of what the observation tells us. And one thing we see is that at least the strongest event, the large events, they all come from large and complex active regions, mostly above sunspot groups. However, you have also CMEs and eruptions in the quiet sun region, mostly for these large filaments involved, but they are neither very fast, usually, nor very energetic. And One thing we also note is that they always seem to occur about polarity inversion lines of magnetic fields. So you have field coming out and field going in to the sun, and in between, that's what we call neutral line or polarity inversion line, and the eruptions are always coming from these places, even for quiet sun eruptions. And yeah, it's coming. So another thing to note is that these three types I have shown you, flares, prominence, eruptions, CMEs, in the, at least in the large events, they always occur together. So they are not independent from each other. And here is one example. Here this dark stuff is the prominence, and you can see how much it expands, and here you see the flare loops coming after this filament eruption. And of course there was also a CME, which you don't really see here in this limited field of views. So this indicates to us that there is some global underlying instability, and so some kind of disruption of the magnetic fields. And these three things are just different observational manifestations. Okay, so now going on in what is causing these events, here I put a little table, two little tables from a paper by Terry Forbes. And so what you can see here, these are estimations of the energy you need for a relatively large CME. And if you do these estimations, you end up at something like 100 erg per cubic centimeter. This is the energy you need to account for the kinetic energy of the CME and what you have during the flare. And then if you make estimations of the energies which are available, you see that it's only the magnetic energy which can provide you this kind of number. Everything else, kinetic energy, thermal, gravitational, is way too small. So from this we conclude that eruptions are really magnetically driven. And next thing to note is if you look at these movies of the evolution of the field at the surface, at the photosphere, here is actually, you saw this little brightness here in this area, boom, there it was. This was a very strong flare, actually one of those I showed a few slides before. But you notice that the evolution of the magnetic field at the surface is hardly affected by that. So that means that the field is basically stationary on the time scale of eruptions. And so what we believe is that the energy, magnetic energy you need, the free magnetic energy, comes not from the surface or below, but it's stored in the corona. Here, what you see here is a so-called nonlinear force-free magnetic field extrapolation. So we cannot measure the field systematically in the coronal volume. So what we do is we take the photospheric measurements and we extrapolate it to get an idea how the field in the coronal volume looks. And this is actually for the very same event here. And so if people do this, they find that there are volumetric currents. And these currents in the corona, this is where the energy is stored, which you need. And so that's what I will refer to as core field. So here actually, I forgot to mention, this red isosurface is an isosurface of current. And the idea is that these currents accumulate, so either they come up by emergence of flux, or they are slowly accumulated in the corona by the stressing of the field at the surface. So this is how you store the energy you need. And now if you put this all together, you get a basic eruption scenario. So prior to an eruption, you have a situation like this. So you have a source region of an eruption, which is energized by flows and flux emergence, and you get sheared and twisted current-carrying fields, which store the energy. And those fields, current-carrying fields, typically want to expand. They are held down by the ambient field surrounding them, which is essentially a potential field. So that's a stable equilibrium situation. Now, however, since the field is constantly stressed and there is new emergence and so on, So at some point, the stressing may exceed some threshold. And when that happens, then the field catastrophically opens up. So that is the initiation of the eruption. And then in the later phase, as the field is stretched out and these field lines are oppositely directed, you create a large-scale vertical current sheet. And finally, reconnection occurring in this current sheet is what magnetic reconnection is, what is causing you the flare. So here's an observation which kind of nicely shows this picture. So this is the basic picture we have. And now, of course, we have to understand the details. In particular, we would like to understand how this field, how the eruption starts in the first place. And this is when then our models come into play. And before I show these models, I would like to make a few general remarks. So basically, all these eruption models are formulated as initial boundary value problems, which means we have a set. Can you read this, actually, this color? OK. We have a set of differential equations. Usually, it's MHD, single fluid MHD we use. We have a set of boundary conditions, which is relatively well constrained. This is essentially what we observe in the photosphere. And we need an initial state in our simulations, which means the pre-eruption state in the corona. And that, because we don't have direct measurements or observations of the magnetic field there, is, of course, less well known. So we have to make guesses. OK, and
purple is invisible, whatever it is.
Say again?
Your purple is invisible.
OK, I'm sorry. I tried to say it. So that reads initial state, this one, OK? Of course, now we do these models, but there are some limitations one should always keep in mind when you see look at these movies of fancy simulations. First of all, we use MHD approximation, so any kinetic physics is excluded. So we cannot address things like particle acceleration. At least in this kind of models, I will show you. As I said, we don't know the field in the coronal volume, so our initial state, how we start, is more or less ad hoc. There are guides, but still we have to make up something. And finally, as always, our computer power is limited. So that means what we have to do, first of all, we have to remove complexity. We cannot do simulations, let's say, based off current magnetograms, which, I don't know, have 4,000 times 4,000 pixels. So we cannot really use this information. It's not possible to make such simulations. So we have to remove complexity. We have to make it simpler. And the second thing is that there is a vast range of length scales involved in these eruptions, from the microphysics in flares up to coronal mass ejections, which can have millions of megameters. And also, this is not possible. We cannot do this in one simulation yet. So we have to simplify many things. OK, still, these models are variables because we can test with them proposed mechanisms. And as you will see later on, we are slowly getting to more and more realism. OK, this brings me finally to the first point I was mentioning at the beginning, how are eruptions triggered. Now, this by itself is a big topic, and there is a lot of controversy about this, so I cannot go into that. There are a bunch of models, and these are only a few which have been proposed. And I have been working on one of them, which is called flux rope instability, and I want to show you a little bit about that only. So flux rope instability, here's a motivation. Why do we consider this? If you look at the observations, what we often see is, for example, here's a prominence. We see one single loop-shaped structure, typically with fixed foot points at the surface. We see twist, internal twist in these eruptions quite often. And we see also, not always, but in considerable number of cases, we see some kind of helical deformation or rotation as the structure moves out. And this suggests, first of all, that we have a flux rope geometry in the underlying magnetic field, at least at this time of the eruption. And in particular, this helical deformation indicates the occurrence of the so-called kink instability, or helical kink instability. That's a current-driven instability which occurs in magnetic flux rope once the twist, that means the winding of the field lines about the axis, exceeds a certain threshold. So this is suggestive, this deformation, that this instability, at least in some cases, may trigger the eruption. And so this is some work I have done a few years ago. Here's this is a coronal flux rope model by Titov and Demoulin. It's an analytical model which describes a twisted flux rope fixed here at the surface. And we have used this model as our initial condition for simulations in a relatively simplified environment. And here is an example what you can get out of this. Here is magnetic field lines of this model in the simulation. Now, the twist is a free parameter in this model. You can choose your twist more or less freely, so you can choose it in a way that it is above this instability threshold. And so then your simulation will model this instability. And this we compared to a filament eruption, which was observed here by Trace 10 years ago. And you see there is a quite nice agreement. So this indicates that, at least in this case, this instability was triggering the eruption. And essentially, a very, very similar model was developed by Yuhong and Sara here at HAO at the same time. And now, this is nice result, but these simulations, they don't give you a CME. In both cases, the simulation was confined, and actually what you see here is a confined eruption. So you have sometimes filament eruptions which start out like usual, but then they get stuck, and they can't manage to escape from the sun. And if I would play this movie longer, you see that that is slowly losing its integrity, and there was no CME here. And the reason for that is we believe that if this ambient field is too strong, that it may just stop the eruption.
Okay. Still flare?
Yes. Here you see all this brightening, so you can even have X-class flares where with confined eruptions. There are some papers on that. So here it's not able, it goes up to 80 megameters, but it's not able to leave the sun. So that's what I just said. And so the question is if there's something else involved. And one mechanism we were looking at is what we call torus instability. This is for plasma physicists, they may know this, I think it's called horizontal tokamak instability. So this stuff has been studied for quite a while in fusion research, but has not been applied to CMEs. Okay, to give you an idea what this means is, let's look at such a ring current. So you have a current flowing in this ring geometry. And if you have something like that, this is not stable, because if the curvature of the current gives you an outward directed force, which is often referred to as the hoop force, and so this current ring just wants to expand. And one way to look at this is if you look at field lines. So this is a cut. Imagine that you cut here through the cross section, and now you look from the side. Okay, so here is your current, and that's the magnetic field it's producing. Now all the field it's producing outside has to go also inside the ring, basically here. Okay, so the field is much more packed there, and you have a much stronger magnetic pressure inside than outside. So this thing simply wants to expand. Now, if you want to keep it stable, you can add an external field. So if you take a field like this in this simple sketch, you make the field stronger here and you make it weaker here, and if you choose the right field, then you can end up with an equilibrium situation. So this additional field gives you a second force, restoring force, which points inwards, and so you can get an equilibrium. And understand this is important because we see these prominences of filaments, as I said, stable for weeks or months, and then suddenly they go. So before eruption, they are basically in a stable state. Okay, so now what is this torus instability? Now imagine you would perturb this ring. So you start to expand this ring by whatever mechanism. And what happens then as it expands is that this hook force is going down, but also your restoring force will go down, because on the sun, this external field is basically the strapping field, the field which is overlying this core field I showed at the beginning, and that is decaying with height. And now it depends which one, as it expands, which one is dropping faster, okay? So if this restoring force, this one, which holds it back, is dropping faster with distance as it expands than the hook force, then the expansion will not be stopped and you get this instability. Otherwise, and this is probably possibly the case in these confined eruptions, that it is held back and basically stabilized. Okay, and so people have looked at this, and if you can make such a simple ansatz, for example, like this, for these external fields, and then you can do calculations, and you find that there is a critical, we call this decay index, so there is a critical drop of these external fields. If it drops fast enough at a certain height, then the instability can occur. Okay, now on the sun, this is a function of height. Okay, so the steepness of this ambient field will change as you go higher and higher up. And so if you manage to lift your filament or your flux rope up to that height where you reach this critical index, then this instability can occur, otherwise not. Okay, so here's a simulation. All these calculations were done basically for a freely expanding current ring. On the sun, we have a different situation. We have partial rings, flux ropes, which are anchored at the surface. So we tested this in numerical simulations where you have this situation, and we found actually that these values are pretty similar. So on the sun, what does it mean? It means that, as I just said, if you have your structure, stable structure, if by some mechanism you lift it up to this critical height at which the stabilizing field drops fast enough, then you can get this instability. And that fits nicely with what you observe in filament eruptions, because you often observe a slow rise phase and then you get a second fast acceleration phase. Now this initial lifting, this can be by many possible mechanisms. One would be, for example, the kink instability. So if these work together, you may get a full eruption. Or it can be tether cutting, cancellation, which slowly lifts it up, things like that. Okay, then that's not the whole story. Of course, what reconnection is also important. Now, these instabilities I just showed you, they require a flux rope structure. And this is a debated topic, quite debated, if there is a flux rope or not. Prior to eruption, is it formed during the eruption, later on in the early phase, and so on. So one thing reconnection can do, and this is explained, for example, in this tether cutting model, that it can slowly transform your shear arcade, which you see here, like these two elbows. If they come together, they reconnect. For example, this can be done by slow flows, which bring the magnetic field together. And then you can form a flux rope structure. And later on, when the eruption occurs, then reconnection becomes also very important, as it happens here below the erupting structure. As I mentioned before, this is what essentially gives you the flare. But this reconnection can also weaken still the overlying field by bringing line-tight feed lines together. So they reconnect and they add to the erupting structure. So reconnection can be actually a driver of eruptions in addition to these ideal instabilities. And this is, as I said in the beginning, this is still controversial. So different people have different views on this, and we have to do more work on all that. The other thing is reconnection may also happen above the eruptive structure. If you have a quadrupolar structure with a null point or null line, as you see it here at the beginning. And this may act as a trigger mechanism because it will remove, again, overlying field, which is stabilizing your low-lying core field. And the experience we found in the simulation is that it can also speed up the eruption significantly. So this is probably a mechanism that's important if you want to get a really, really fast CME. But also that's not really clear yet. Okay, final thing I would like to say is that I personally think that all these things work together in eruption. I sometimes see papers where people try to associate an observed eruption to either breakout or tether cutting or kink instability, whatever, and I don't think it works that way. So you have to produce a flux rope first, for example, so you need tether cutting. For fast events, you may need breakout, and so on. And which one is really dominant, that may depend on the configuration, on the circumstances of the eruption. So this is also something we don't really know yet. Okay. Now the second thing I want to show you, though, so this was about the initiations, and now it's about coupling of eruptions. So here's a movie where you see there was one, here is the second one, here was one, and here was one. So most eruptions, maybe they occur by themselves, but sometimes you have situations where within a relatively short time you have several of them in close or even distant locations. Here's another example. There's two active regions, and they produce two CMEs within something like half an hour. Okay? And so it's an interesting question whether are they really independent or is there maybe some coupling? And people have looked at this. I admit I don't know the studies very much in detail, but they looked at waiting times between flares, typical waiting times. And from that, they concluded that at least some of these events, there should be some link between them. So there is papers by Mike Wetland and by Moon, for example. And people have thought about this for quite some time, and they suggested a number of mechanisms where one eruption could trigger a second one, for example, by waves, large-scale waves triggered by the first eruption, reconnection, of course. In this paper, they discuss surges between going from one active region to the other. Subsurface connections have been discussed, but they're was no modeling of this stuff so far. So, and this is what we tried to do, to develop a model based on the simulations. And we were inspired by these events which took place 1st and 2nd of August 2010. You possibly have seen, Alan Title likes to show these movies here. So actually you can, these are these three color movies where they take three wavelengths from AIA and then they color them differently. And there's a recent paper by Shriver et al. with a link. So you can download these movies from their page. But I warn you, they are really big. It's 2 gigabytes or something. Okay, anyway. So here you can see that stuff is going on, and they looked at this event in a lot of detail, and it was 6 eruptions actually within something like 22, 23 hours. And they did this potential field extrapolations, and they found that all the source regions somehow seem to be connected magnetically. And so what we did is we took a subset of only three eruptions. And this is what you see in the stereo movie. There are three prominences at the limb, a small one down here, this one, and this one. So one, two, three. And here's some snapshots, one, two, three of these eruptions. And one interesting thing is if that, assuming that number one triggered somehow the eruption of two and three, then it's interesting to see that two erupts before three or towards further away. And let's keep that in mind. Now, okay, so here's an H-alpha picture. You see these two, these are two long filaments, two and three. Number one was rather short. Here's a magnetogram. Red is positive flux, blue is negative flux, and the contours of the filaments. And if you do a potential field extrapolation, you see that number two and three, these two large ones, were within the two lobes, each of them in one lobe of what we call pseudo-streamer, which means it's like a Helmholtz streamer, except that the open field polarities are the same and not the opposite. So it's minus, plus, minus, and you get these two lobes. So we were building a rather simple model, which you see here. There are four flux ropes. One, two, and three are aimed to represent these three filaments. And this guy we just put in for symmetry reasons. It's simply easier to build such a configuration like that. And this is a simple approach. This is a zero beta approximation. And we ignore any details like the different sizes, asymmetries of the neutral line, and so on. So this is a kind of proof of concept simulation. Okay, let me show you what happens, what we did. So here you see now the three flux rope, then there is one here, but it is, does not really participate. So we trigger the eruption of this first flux rope. This is done by imposing flows below it, which converge towards the polarity inversion line. This slowly expands the overlying field. The flux rope adjusts so that it's lifted up to a critical height, and then it erupts. And then, otherwise, we do nothing. And I show you a movie what happens. So that's an initial relaxation. Then this guy goes, and you see that some stuff is going on here. And the gray, actually, this transparent plane in gray, this shows you currents. Okay, so you see there's a current sheet forming, then this guy erupts, and later on, the other one. Now that's a bit quick, so let me show you some stills. So here's a snapshot when the first eruption is underway. Now as it expands, it pushes against this well, it's not really a null point, it's a null line, if you want, a separator. So here the magnetic field is very weak. And if you perturb structures like this, you will get current layers. And that's what's happening here. This is pushing against this structure here, and you see that there is a current layer forming here. And in the model, then you get reconnection between these pink and green field lines. So the open field lines here and the closed field lines here. And as this happened, these green field lines, which are actually holding the flux rope down, they open up or they go, they get transformed to this other lobe. So it's like in a magnetic breakout model, if you want. So what you do is that you put all the overlying field out of the way, and then the flux rope is not stabilized anymore, and it erupts, what you see here. And then in the second step, as in every flux rope eruption, you will get a vertical current sheet, which I showed at the beginning, below the erupting structure. That's what you see here. And then again, you get reconnection. And now this field, which has been put above this flux rope and has been opened up here, now they reconnect a second time. And this reconnection is actually even stronger because it involves stronger fields lower down. So what happens then is that this closed field opens up again. And so finally, this flux rope isn't stabilized either, and it can erupt. So basically, these two reconnection events, they can, each of them triggers a new eruption in this particular magnetic field configuration. So yeah, so this is a nice model because it gives you an idea how this may happen. And the interesting thing is also that it reproduces the correct order of eruption. So the guy who is further away from the first eruption erupts first, simply due to the fact that the reconnection here, it depends on the orientation of this current sheet. It involves these fields. So if you would orient the current sheet by some other perturbation like this, then you would get the opposite. Then this would erupt first. Okay, so all this is nice. However, it's of course difficult to confirm. It's just a model. It's difficult to confirm if in this event this really happened or not. I mean, it's really hard. And also observations are, will not really tell you because this reconnection, at least the first one, is has hardly any signatures in observation if it occurred at all. So my colleague Slava Titov, he did a very detailed study of the topology of the magnetic field. At the time of these events, there is a paper you can look up if you're interested. And so this is really complex stuff. It's based on magnetograms and potential field extrapolations. And he looks at many, many details. And at least the scenario he found for this, which is based on observed data, seems to support this scenario. So at least in this particular event, it may have indeed happened. And yeah, so we need, of course, more realistic simulations if we want to confirm that better. And my colleague Zoran Mikic is actually working on that right now, and I'll show you a little bit about that in a second. I'm good with time still, or? Yeah? Okay. All right, so now, these two models I have showed you are still relatively idealized and simple. You can get out a lot of them, I think. And the big advantage they have is that they are cheap computationally. So you can even run this on a workstation. So they're very good to study and test. You can do parametric studies of these basic physical mechanisms you think are at work. But there is another way to go, another family if you want. These are let's call them state-of-the-art models, and they try to be to model more realistically. So let me show you a little bit how that is done. First of all, those models, they use large domains, spherical domains, to really model the corona and even further out, well, up to 1 AU. They include a solar wind. Here is one example. So the Michigan group, for example, is doing this. So here's the Earth, here's the Sun. So they have these really big grids, and they try to model the whole thing up to Earth. Often or typically, they involve photospheric measured fields. So it's not one analytical model, but they use indeed data as a boundary condition. And more recently, there is also there is more physics in these models in terms of energy transport in the corona. So people now use some empirical coronal heating. There is thermal conduction, and there is radiative losses. And you need this kind of stuff if you really want to try to make the emission right, which you see in satellites. In particular, between active regions, quiet sun, coronal holes. So here's an example what you can get. This is a simulation done by Jung Mok and collaborators. Now, this is on active region scale, and it's a synthetic, I think, EIT 171, if I'm not mistaken, image. So if you put on all these, let's evolved stuff, then you really start to see loops and this kind of things in your simulations. So now how does this work if you want a full corona and CMEs? So I call this thermodynamic. That means that you have coronal heating, you have radiation losses and thermal conduction. And so of course you want the whole sun and you want to use magnetograms, which you don't have because we don't have continuous observation. So what is typically done is that people use these so-called synoptic magnetograms, which are accumulated over typically one solar rotation. It's of course a bit dangerous because things are changing during this time, but yeah, that's what we can do at present. So you have this, you put it on your sphere, and you make an extrapolation of the magnetic field, potential field extrapolation, and then you put this into your MHD simulation where you have then all the physics. And what happens then is that the field opens up, there is also solar wind in there, and so basically you relax this to some steady state. Okay. Now you want to test how good is your model, and by this you do by creating synthetic satellite images. So you model what the satellite would do. So here's an example. Here are the observations. These are six different wavelengths by AIA, and this is what these models give you. Okay. And now, of course, this you can use in order to improve your models and to see what to do to get better. So people in our group, they do this they work very actively in further improving this kind of models. Okay, so now in order to make an eruption, what we do at present is now we have this nice model with more realistic plasma density, temperature, and so on. But now we have to energize the source region in order to get the CME, because this does not include these twisted and sheared fields so far. And so there are two ways to do this. One way is you take an analytical flux rope model like this Titov-Demoulin model I showed you before, and you kind of just insert it into your global solution. You can do this either in a stable way, or you choose the parameters of your flux rope such that it is not in equilibrium and will give you immediately an eruption. So this is done in many papers recently. Or you try to do this a bit more self-consistently by using photospheric flows, shear flows, even emergence, in order to produce such a structure in your eruption source region, which carries the current and the free energy. And then what is typically done is, again, that if it's unstable in the first place, you don't have to trigger it. But if you start from a stable configuration like this one, what is mostly done is to impose these converging flows towards the neutral line, which is actually also observed. So very often this, there is flux cancellation before and during these eruptions. So if you do that, now you can basically like in the models before, but now you have this sophisticated global model, and also of course you can now do again the synthetic images of the eruptions. So here's a test case which we are playing a little bit with. In this case it's an idealized eruption, so this is not based on real data. Okay, then further out, what you can do is that you can also produce synthetic coronagraph images. Here is a LASCO image. It's a running difference or running ratio, I don't know. This is a running ratio image. So you divide your image at the time by the previous one. So, and that brings out the structures more clearly. And now one advantage you have, of course, is in the observations by LASCO or so, you are forced for one viewing angle, that's it. But in the numerical data, you can now look from every possible viewing angle and do the integration of the density. So here's an example. This is one viewing angle. This is another one, that's polarization brightness, and this is running ratio. And you can see already that it's the same eruption, but depending on the viewing angle, they can look quite differently. And I think that's quite important also for observers if you try to estimate mass, kinetic energy, and so on. So we have not looked yet into this in detail, but we hope we can do that soon. Okay, now finally, simulations I showed you, these so-called thermodynamic simulations, they are very, very expensive computationally. So you don't want to do this out to 1 AU. And I mean, you can, but it's expensive. And so what you can do is to couple codes. This is a case which Roberto Leonello did recently. So you take a heliospheric code which simulates the whole domain except the coronal domain. So here this little white sphere is the simulation I just showed you. You take the boundary conditions you get from there and you feed it into a second code which has simpler physics and therefore can run faster. And if you do this properly, and you have to test this, of course, how smooth this transition is, but you can use this then to prolong this eruption which you have modeled out to 1 AU or even beyond. So here, this would be the Earth, this red circle. And you can do then, of course, once you have this, you can do a synthetic in situ measurements at 1 AU. So this is roughly where we stand. And of course, you want to use all this to model observed events. And here are just two examples we are working on. This is, again, this August 1st sympathetic events. Here is the thermodynamic or full MHD, if you want, model of the corona. And parallel, we do zero beta because it's faster and simpler. We try to model these eruptions. Here you see a little bit. So that's ongoing stuff. And once we have the right parameters in zero beta that we are happy with, then we would insert this flux rope into the solution and hopefully get nice eruptions. That's another case, the Bastille Day event. This is still zero beta here too. And okay, that's basically it. So let me summarize. I hope I could show you that idealized, relatively simple numerical models of eruptions are already quite helpful to study the basic physical mechanisms, initiation, driving, possibly coupling between eruptions. And the global simulations, more realistically, they are now slowly emerging and they are feasible now computationally. Those use real data. You have improved plasma descriptions. So hopefully you will get deeper insight in parts of the physics and you can have a relatively realistic modeling with this. Okay, and what I just showed, there is now a coupling between this expensive coronal simulations to the heliosphere, where I think relatively soon, in a few years, I think we should be capable to do this kind of models, well, of observed events up to 1 AU, which will help, of course, for space weather prediction. Still, these models are still simplified. So I mentioned a huge range of length scales present in solar eruptions. We don't have this in these models yet. The complete set of plasma equations, and as well our boundary and initial conditions are still simplified. We cannot use one-to-one a magnetogram. We have to smooth it down to something simpler. More is not possible at present. And finally, my last slide, a little outlook of what will be the next steps and what people are doing already. So one thing people are using is what is called adaptive mesh refinement, which means that locally in your grid, as your simulation proceeds, you locally increase the resolution of your grid in places where you think it's important to have this resolution. For example, of course, where reconnection takes place. So this kind of improves. I mean, you cannot model reconnection still self-consistently, but it's improvement. You start to see, this is a simulation, recent one by Judy Carpen. You start to see plasmoids and this kind of things, which you typically don't have in this MHD simulations I showed you before. Also for shocks, this would be nice to have. And people have started to couple actually MHD simulations and particle in cell simulations. So here is an example. They took the MHD simulations. In that case, it's a flux emergence simulation by Moreno and Surtis, and they take this magnetic field for their particle code, and this will, of course, improve modeling of particle acceleration, things like that. Another thing to do is, and this has also been started recently by Ilya, and also Zoran Mikic is working on this, is to couple simulations of flux emergence or nonlinear force free field extrapolations to the CME models. So that will help us to get more realistic, hopefully to get more realistic initial configurations, which, as I said in the beginning, are more or less ad hoc. And another thing we have to do is to work more on this evolutionary MHD models. So all the simulations I showed you now, they, you do your CME at one particular point in time of the corona. So it's, so to say, a static corona. And all you do then is to launch your flux rope. And of course, in reality, everything is in movement, and flux emerges all over the place, things like that. And people have started to do this kind of things. Here, Duncan McCabe and Yeats, for example, this is done by so-called magneto-frictional relaxation. So this is not MHD yet. Or Mark Chung and Fisher, they work on this kind of things. So this is something to go, and then of course at some point with full MHD. And so I'm convinced we will see some surprises if we do this in terms of how the eruption, a particular eruption evolves. And then of course the long-term goal of all this, I mean all this is still very expensive computationally, but we would like to get to a point where we can use these models and simulate the CMEs in real time, meaning that the CME, we see the CME starting, we start the model, and if we're lucky, we are done before it hits the Earth. But that's really past, that's way away in the future. Okay, that's it. Thank you very much.
Questions for Tibor?
How long before accurate modeling of the magnetic field within the CME can be expected? Is this something that if all these pieces come together, might be able to get a handle on that, or is it still some years away?
Accurate modeling, you mean of the pre-eruption configuration, for example? I wish I could give you a number. I don't know. I mean, as I said, we have to, it depends what you want to look in, you know. Maybe there is a certain limit where you don't have to go further in terms of accuracy, which is just details. So right now, we remove a lot of complexity, and I don't really know, because we can only say this finally when we have these models to compare how good we are now, you know. So. But it will be more than a few years, definitely, I think.
Could you tell us what's the simplified physics in the outer model of the so the wind to which you linked your coronal model?
It's a heliospheric code, you mean?
Yes.
This is without, there is no heating anymore. I mean, far out like this, you can assume constant temperature. And so there is no coronal heating, there is no thermal conduction, and there is no radiative losses, which is in these models in the coronal part. So that's basically all. You just don't use this sophisticated stuff. Because that's very, very expensive. In particular, thermal conduction has the property to bring your time step down very, very low.
How does your work compare to Batsaras?
What exactly you mean?
Well, I mean, could you comment on you know, what are the patent claims that you have achieved with your codes,
mm-hmm.
where you try to match several systems together?
Well, it's in an early state. I mean, what we try to do is, more importantly, I think, is lower down. So we try to start eruptions from equilibrium. Of course, you can. What they do so far is that they plug in a flux rope, which is out of equilibrium. And of course, this erupts immediately. And I think for certain things, that's fine. If you look further out, how shocks occur or whatever. And if you are close to the real equilibrium, maybe that's even fine. But if you then really want to be quantitative, you will have a problem. Besides, you cannot check this because you cannot relax your configuration after insertion or after energization first to compare after that with the observations, like things like sigmoids or something like that. So this is something we aim at to do. And otherwise, I think further out so far, it's probably the same thing, I guess. But that's new. I mean, Roberto, we have just developed this code, and Roberto made now a few tests, so we have not used this yet at our group for a real event. So that remains to be seen.
Okay, I have a very naive question. And you say that you don't consider the kinetic effect. And of course you don't, because those are MHD simulation. So in the MHD, I think it's reasonable to do an MHD simulation because the time scales for this event are such that you don't have to resolve the very small temporal scales. But when you do MHD, you are assuming also a thermal equilibrium. Mm-hmm. But as you were pointing out, I mean, that those events are connected with huge release of energy. So how the fact that you consider local thermal equilibrium affect the results of your simulation? Because from this point of view, probably taking into account the kinetic effect would make them more realistic, or not?
Probably yes. I mean, I think for modeling CMEs, it's fine. Yeah, for CME evolution and the fluid evolution of plasma is probably well described by this. For flares, it's more problematic, of course. I don't know, we cannot do it yet, so.
You should do kinetic simulation, which are, of course, massively expensive for
Well, I know that the Michigan group is trying to do that now locally. They started to work on that. But
because when you eat the plasma, the distribution functions of the plasma particles depart from a Maxwellian.
Oh, yeah. I mean, we are not, these simulations at this stage is really more the CME aspect.
Okay.
We will not get, for example, the flare emission right. No way. We have no particles whatsoever. So basically, you have just conduction fronts, which this you can model. But and I see this in the tests I did for Bastille Day. We get temperatures of maybe 6-7 million Kelvin, but never more than 10 or even 30. This is not yet possible. Maybe one day.
Thank you.
I really enjoyed your talk, and I had just a curiosity question. In your three coupled events, the 1, 2, 3,
yes.
In your model, you actually had to have 4 lobes. So I was just wondering what happened to the 4th one, if anything.
In that case, well, nothing is not the right word, but it did not erupt. It was, let me just go quick back quickly, if I can go back quickly. Ah, here we go. Sorry. Come on. Yeah, so as I said, I mean, I first did it only with 3 flux rope, but it's a bit nasty to find a nice initial equilibrium. And in that case, what happened as these two guys went off, it's pushed a bit to the side, it comes back, not to the very same position, but basically there's some kind of oscillation, that's it. Because you see all the feed lines here are in the same direction. So if you just expand this field, there is no reconnection occurring here, or maybe a little bit if there is a certain angle. But so this one remains stable.
More questions for Tibor? Does your last picture show you're pretty optimistic about the future of the CME prediction?
Yeah.
Well, thank you. Yeah.